Welcome back, whiskey fans. But today, got some bad news for you. There's no whiskey review. Today, I'm going to start off March Malternatives. And the reason for that is partly because I do find that it's getting harder and harder to find good value for money in the Scotch whiskey world. As we found on the V-Pub, those value for money bottlings are still out there. They can still be had, but it is getting harder. But more than that, I think that it's very important with your spirits to keep an open mind and make sure that you try everything that the world of spirits has to offer. I think that trying different spirits improves your palate and allows for a greater appreciation of all flavours, including appreciation of Scotch whisky. And on the subject of different spirits, I want to give a brief shout out to a channel I've been watching a lot of lately, and that's Scott over at Different Spirits. He does whisky reviews over there, as well as rum, claren, eau de vie. Lots and lots of different spirits. Fantastic channel, I'll link in the description below. Go and give them a sub. So today I'm going to be doing the first of four March Malternatives. This is going to run over into April. And today we're going to be looking at this. Sorry, this. Yeah, that one. I always get those two confused for some reason. Don't know why. So this is a Jamaican favourite. It's Wray Nephew White Overproof Rum. So hopefully you'll agree that I think the presentation on this one, it's very different to your average Scotch whisky. It's a clear spirit that comes in clear glass, and this label is, I would describe it as attractive but pragmatic. Seriously though, I do love the branding on this. I think that it's, the colours are really bold, it gives you all the information you need. I do think that you can tell that they have a little bit of a monopoly on the Jamaican rum market, because there is a little bit of an air of, we don't need to try that hard with the branding and the label on this one. But I think it's really nice. It's retro, it's no nonsense, it's not afraid to speak its name. I love it. Another thing about this is part of the reason why this stuff, apart from the colour scheme, why this really reminds me of Jif Lemon. The top on this, it's a plastic moulded screw top. When you undo it, it comes away from this bottom bit, which is locked in place. Very well engineered little closure, and it actually has a dribbler insert stuck into the top. You can pull these out if it really bothers you. But at 63% ABV, yes, you heard me right, 63 ABV, that's not proof. It's probably best to leave the dribbler insert in, because after a couple of these, your hand-eye coordination is going to be all over the place and you're going to need all the help you can get. Of course, I'm joking, drink in moderation. But at 63% ABV and £28, I think this stuff is incredibly good value. With the strength of this stuff, you're essentially getting the same amount of alcohol as you would get from buying just over a whole litre of 40% rum. And obviously with that 63% overproof strength, you are guaranteed to be able to drink this at whatever drinking strength your heart desires. And if you are curious, this stuff can be watered right down to 40%. It takes water and swims incredibly well, but it's also really not necessary. Before we get into the nosing and the tasting, I also want to give a quick shout out to my good friend Welsh Toro. He's been my behind the scenes rum advisor on this review and these upcoming reviews. Rum has always been something that I've enjoyed, but as always, with the help of community, with the help of Welsh Toro on these reviews, he's really pointed me in the direction of some that really go above and beyond the rest, and I hope to share some of those with you in the next four reviews. I'll hold this up to the camera so you can see the dribbler in action. It's probably not going to be in focus, but when's that new? So I'm going to be bold. I'm going to upend it and see, comically, if we can rely on that dribbler. Perfect. And as you might expect, being a white overproof rum, looks actually surprisingly hazy, but looks essentially like water. No colour to this at all. Bizarrely, there are actually some white rums on the market which are barrel aged, and then they remove the colour later. Completely bizarre, but I believe that this hasn't seen any ageing at all. It's unaged at 63% ABV. Pretty much the same as it comes off the still. So Let's get the top on that before it all evaporates. Wray and Nephew, white Jamaican overproof rum on the nose. Really strong hit of banana, sweetened confectionery banana, a little bit like those banana, foam banana sweets that you can get, which reminds me a little bit of French whiskey from Bren Cuvée, but really this is so much better. Very sugary though, sugary, confectionery, refined sugar on the nose. Bit of a note of tinned fruit and syrup, like tinned pineapple. Slightly lemony, a little bit of a Jif lemon note, or is there? It's definitely got some bite to it though. It's not a sweet and inoffensive affair. It's got a little bit of an industrial kind of metal polish, shoe polish note to it. Also a little bit of a note of mineral oil. Going back into the fruitiness, sweet, sugary bananas, raisins and sultanas on the nose, as well as a little bit of a slightly funky, farmy note, a little bit of a note kind of like distant cow sheds. Now, obviously, this being a white Jamaican overproof rum, it's not peaty. They're not using peat in the process of this. But I do think that it has a slightly phenolic and very interesting Jamaican funk to it. So, how many people that haven't tried this already thought that I was going to come out with as many tasting notes as I just did based on just the nose of this? Because I definitely wouldn't have guessed that. It's an absolute surprise to me that this is actually a very, very complex, well-made, and very interesting, and very characterful rum. Let's see how it tastes. Not much to see there. Definitely lots to taste though. Now, as you've seen, I am nosing and tasting this at the full 63% ABV, and I think that's absolutely fine. I don't feel the need to add any water to this at all. Obviously, I am accustomed to my cask strength whiskies, and my thoughts are always, if it's well made, if they've done a good enough job, then the vast majority of the time you shouldn't have to add water to whiskey. And I think that's the same case with this. It's a wonderfully made, very smooth, easy drinking product, and I think that the 63% is absolutely fine, and that's the way that I've drunk on the majority of this bottle over the last few weeks. Although I would be lying if I didn't say that there was a little bit of a raw alcohol hit on the palate of this one, but it's really nothing offensive. It just shows you the strength and intensity in this spirit. You're never going to get a 63% spirit which doesn't have a little bit of a burn, but really this is very smooth, no immaturity. It's very, very well made with no harshness and actually surprisingly little heat considering that it is 63% and has had no aging. It's going to have another sip, small sip. Sweet, light and fruity on the palate. Lots of tropical fruit and also a really strong note of brown sugar. Really lots of burnt sugariness, burnt sugar, brown sugar, molasses. It's also quite a saltiness on the late palate and finish of this one. And a little bit of a kind of urea kidney note. So a slight bitter metallic meatiness on the late palate of this one, which really ties in with that traditional Jamaican funk that we associate with a lot of Jamaican rums. As for the finish on this one, as you might expect for a 63% spirit, it's very long and very warming with lots of those burnt brown sugar and molasses notes. So, as you might have guessed from the fact that I cheekily included this on my list of you only need 5 whiskies, I really, really like this stuff. It really surprised me. It surprised me just how good it is, just how much character it's got, and how drinkable it is for something that's so, so strong that's never seen a cask. Also really, really surprised me when Welsh Toro recommended this stuff, and I had never seen this before. Well, I'd never seen it in a shop, or so I thought, But this stuff, they actually sell it in UK supermarkets. It's possibly not in a place where the whisky enthusiasts are going to look. In the supermarkets around here, at least, it's kind of at foot level, right at the bottom, underneath all of the other rums. But if I'd have known years ago just how good this stuff was, I would have been buying it. I will probably always have a bottle of this in the house, now that I know how good it is and how cheap it is. It's just such a lovely, smooth and focused, but definitely not bland and absolutely definitely not weak rum. Very, very bold flavours, excellent mouthfeel. It really gives you that lovely warming character, absolutely beautiful drink for a cold day. And more than anything, I'm just really surprised at how complex and just full of funky character this stuff is. Going back to that warming property of the finish of this rum though, you can really see why in Jamaica and certain parts of the world they call these white overproof rums kill devil, with the kind of implying that it's a bit of a cure-all. It's used as kind of a universal, unofficial, almost medicine. Because if you have got a little bit of a stuffiness, a little bit of a blocked nose, or you can feel a cold coming on, I'm not saying that this stuff is going to cure you, but it will absolutely clear your sinuses out and make you feel better. So you can really tell why they call this stuff kill devil, or why in the old days, centuries ago, when the monks first started distillation, like the early days of gin and stuff, they would call it aqua vitae, the water of life, or eau de vie. And you can really see how things like this became used as a kind of cure-all. And you can also absolutely see why they say that there's a bottle of this in almost every household in Jamaica, because it's just hugely flavorful, enjoyable, and really fun for something that's had no aging at all. And I think that really shows a lot of the key differences between whiskey and rum. But it does also make me a little bit sad, and it makes me wish that more whiskey distilleries would sell Cleric, New Make, Aqua Vitae, the raw stuff straight off the still. And it's not every whiskey distillery that can do that, but I know from first-hand experience that some whisky distilleries, their new make is really good stuff in a similar vein to this. And it's a shame that it's so inaccessible. Now, obviously, whisky is a very different thing to rum. Immature whisky can be absolutely awful, and there are aspects of cask aging that you absolutely can't fake, no matter what the NAS brigade will tell you. But after tasting this stuff and really falling in love with it, I'd say that it's very important not to be too snobbish or be too afraid of unaged spirits, especially when it comes to rum. Very, 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 very highly recommended if you think you can handle it. Thanks for watching, and join me for the next rum review. Cheers.